right, good evening. I'd like to call this meeting to order of the City Creeks Restoration and Water Quality Improvement Committee. Can we please get roll call?
Mr. Smith? Ms. Lomas? Mr. Moldaver? Ms. Weber? Ms. French? Thank you.
All right, first we'd like to get approval of the minutes from our April 17th meeting.
So moved. As submitted.
Can we get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All right, is there any public comment? Okay, moving on to our first business item, we're going to get a presentation from Jeff Brinkman from Ecology Consultants on our bioassessment program.
Okay, there we go. Thanks for the introduction, and thanks for having me back for another year of the bioassessment presentation. Do I click on this? Pop up? Or? Oh, there we go. Okay, sorry. All right, so the Southern Coastal Santa Barbara Creeks and Estuaries, now we're doing estuaries as well, bioassessment program. This is just a picture of Mission Creek here up at Rocky Nook, which is one of our study sites for the creeks. I know a lot of this is probably review for you guys from last year and the year before, but we'll just kind of go through some general stuff here. Again, the purpose of the bioassessment program, this is a long-term monitoring program for creeks and estuaries, looking at the condition of the ecosystems in our study area. We're trying to understand how they respond to natural influences, things like climate and wildfires and that kind of stuff, as well as human influences. That includes trying to detect human impacts from development, water pollution, and allows us to potentially investigate those based on the sites we're looking at. The program is also intended to help us look at the effectiveness of our restoration efforts that the city has been undertaking with the creeks and estuaries. So our study area is basically the southern Santa Barbara County coast from the Ventura County line all the way west out to Point Conception. We actually are looking at an estuary out at Halama. So we've extended our study area in the past year a little bit to the west. The creeks we've been studying now for 13 years. We've done a lot of work with the creeks so far. It is a cooperative effort between the city and county. We have funding from both. We look at approximately 15 to 20 creek sites every year. Within the city, we have four sites in the Mission Creek watershed, two in Sycamore, and three this year in Arroyo Burro watershed. And with these sites, each year, and then specifically with respect to our entire data set over the years, we're looking at a full range of conditions here, from our more pristine sites up in the mountains and out on the Gaviota Coast, to our more highly impacted reaches in the urban areas, like, for example, Mission Creek in the downtown area. Estuaries, we just kind of gotten going looking at the estuaries. Last year was our second year of study. And we looked at six sites last year. We expanded a bit. The first year we only looked at three. And three sites, including Mission Creek, Sycamore Creek, and Arroyo Burro estuaries, are within the city limits. These represent our more disturbed sites, more urbanized watersheds. And then we've attempted to find the least impacted estuaries that we can find in the study area. And we've come up with Gaviota Creek, Halama Creek, and Tecolote Creek estuaries as the best representatives that we could find. So just a little more background on what exactly is rapid bioassessment. In case you're wondering, it's using the biota, so using the living organisms in the ecosystem as our indicator of ecological condition. We focus on the benthic invertebrate community, which is what most studies focus on throughout the country and throughout the world when they're doing bioassessment. They're readily collectible, very diverse communities, relatively easy to identify and understand. There's been a lot of work done, and there's a lot of understanding as to their pollution tolerances and that type of useful information. A benthic invertebrate is just something that's greater than a half millimeter in size. It won't slide through a half millimeter mesh net that we collect them with. They can get bigger. They can be, you know, an inch and a half, 2 inches long. Some of the dragonfly larvae, for example. They can be in the stream for up to, you know, 2 to 3 years, or, you know, as little as a month or two. So why are we using the biota rather than, let's say, traditional water chemistry measurements, which are also, you know, have their place for sure and their usefulness. But with the bioassessment, it's very proven. It's cost effective. We can get a lot of information for a relatively little amount of money compared to some of the other options. Benthic invertebrates, like all living things, have varying tolerances to disturbance, so different species of invertebrates can handle a high level of water pollution, a high level of habitat disturbance. Others can't. So based on what you see in a given ecosystem, whether it's a stream, an estuary, or another water body, the invertebrates that we find there tell us a lot about the overall condition. And they're there for the long term. They're integrating the changing conditions through time. We all know that water bodies fluctuate, you know, with streams. They fluctuate in their flow level. Their chemistry can fluctuate. With estuaries, the salinity can fluctuate widely. So the biota are integrating and living in this environment over a long period of time, whereas water chemistry, again, has just given us a snapshot and telling us what we have at that moment in time. Also useful, especially when it comes to trying to determine where different pollutants are coming from. But the biota gives us that long-term measure. So what do we actually do with our bioassessment surveys? We do the field surveys where we go out each year. I was just out in the creeks today doing some surveys. We collect the benthic invertebrates with our nets and get the bottom substrate and put them in our bottles with ethanol to preserve them. We do some basic water chemistry monitoring with our meters. We do a physical habitat assessment where we're visually scoring different components of the habitat, the stream bottom substrate, the flow level, the diversity of riffles and pools, the condition of the riparian community, those type of things, as well as compiling plant and vertebrate species lists and other general observations. So it takes about an hour and a half, 2 hours to do a survey on one of the streams. We take the samples back to the laboratory, we pick the bugs out, we identify them. That's how we calculate our metrics. We'll get into that a little bit later. And how we also calculate our index of biotic integrity scores for each study reach, also known as the IBI, which we developed for our creeks. I'll talk about that a little bit more in some further slides. And then we summarize all of this as well as other analysis in our annual report, which the 2012 report is now available for review on the city's website. So a little bit more in depth as to what the IBI is, the index of biotic integrity. It's a scoring tool that we've developed through about 10 years of data that we collected in our local creeks and looking at it, the characteristics of the invertebrate community in the streams all the way from highly impacted streams on the coastal plain to our least disturbed streams in the mountains and out on the coast, the Gaviota Coast. We're able to evaluate different metrics like, let's say, aquatic insect diversity. How many insect families do we have? And look at the responses of all of these individual metrics that we can look at. And the ones that have been the most highly correlated with level of human disturbance, we've selected as our core metrics. And we've tried to represent different aspects of the invertebrate community, like diversity, composition, what percentage of the bugs that we're collecting are known to be sensitive to pollution versus tolerant to pollution. Those are some of the different composition metrics that we have. As well as trophic structure, you know, what percentage of the bugs are predators and shredders, which shred up the leaves, which percentage of them are collector filterers. We've tried to select from all those different types of categories to give as complete a picture as we can as far as the invertebrate community goes. So we have these seven metrics. They're scored 1 to 10. The total score is between 0 and 70. And then based on that score, we have scoring ranges anywhere from very poor, poor, fair, good, and excellent. So your reference reaches that we look at before we do biological sampling, we say, okay, the watershed's almost completely undisturbed, the stream's in good condition, those should score and you're good to excellent on the IBI if it's reliable. And the highly impacted streams should be in the fair, poor, or very poor category. So this is basically a monitoring tool that simplifies this complex data and provides us a way to evaluate the streams and guide our management decisions. So what have we found? We found the IBI to be highly effective, highly accurate, and reliable. This is a slide here. It's just showing different groups that we determined before sampling. So high disturbed, moderately disturbed, reference would be relatively undisturbed reaches. Those are groups of reaches that we have. And we determine what group they fit into based on how much development they have in their watershed area and what the physical habitat score is. So what we see is we see a really good spread. Each of those little dots are individual data points, but if you look at the diamonds there, the green diamonds, those are showing the mean and the standard error between the high disturbed, moderately disturbed, and reference. And what you see is much higher mean scores for reference compared to moderately disturbed and on down to high disturbed. So the IBI has proven to be very effective thus far. Just getting into some other things that we've been able to look at besides the human disturbance, we've been able to evaluate some of our natural variability, like for example in climate. So we've seen that wet winters, we had 2005, if you look at, that's kind of a confusing, a little bit, there's a lot going on in that graph, but just to break it down for you, if you look at 2005, that was our second wettest year on record. We had really high stream flows, scoured out the stream communities, and we saw a huge drop overall in our IBI scores. And then we see recovery a year later, and more so even another year later. So it shows you that, and there's been some other years like 2008 where we had kind of a wet year, but not a crazy wet year, and you have a little depression in the scores. You can see that the natural variability in stream flow, it shows up in the IBI scores. It definitely has an influence on them, which, you know, that's a big disturbance, so it should. And then we've also been able to evaluate several of our recent fires. What type of effect are our wildfires having where we're burning 60, 70, 80% of the watershed? If you look at the top two lines there, M3, which is blue, and M4, which is red, which are more of our reference sites, you see right before the fire, days before the, it was either the T fire or the Jesuita fire, I can't remember which one. But right before the fire, we have really high IBI scores, and then the fire consumed most of the watershed. We come out the next year, and these reference sites are in the poor category, the invertebrate communities hammered, so to speak. And then over the course of the last 3 years, we've seen steady recovery, and now we're back pretty much to, as of last year, back to our pre-fire community for the most part. So we've been able to document this effect as well and see how it takes years sometimes for these streams to recover. We've also been able to look at a couple of our stream restoration sites, the blue line being Mission Creek, Old Mission Creek at Bonnet Park, which we've been studying now for over 8 years since the initial restoration, 2004. And then AB5 is the Mesa Creek site, which feeds into the Arroyo Burro Estuary. And that, of course, was daylighted in 2007. We've been able to see some, what looks like possibly some moderate improvement in the IBI scores. It'll take time to continue to evaluate those. There's a little bit of variability there from year to year, but we'll see if that upward trend continues. So we've seen possibly some moderate improvements, and it also shows that we have to restore at the watershed level if we're going to have a huge improvement in the stream community. Just planning at a local level certainly has benefits, but we're not going to see a huge lift in the ecosystem functioning unless we focus as much as we can at the watershed level. So that kind of wraps up the creeks. I want to spend a few slides. So we got a few slides left. I want to talk about our estuarine work so far. So this past year, again, we did 6 sites, 3 that were relatively in good condition, 3 that were, you know, in poorer condition. And what we did was we calculated a bunch of biological metrics, things like total abundance, diversity, how many different taxa of invertebrates do we have at these different sites, dominance, functional feeding groups, sensitivity and tolerance, you know, bugs that we know are sensitive, that we know are tolerant, calculated over 30 metrics, and then basically compared those between our groups, our reference sites, our least disturbed, and our more heavily disturbed sites. And we're trying to see if there are differences in the estuaries. And this, if that is the case, could show us some promise that we might be able to develop a tool similar to our Creekside BI to evaluate the estuaries. What we found so far is there's a lot less spread between a relatively undisturbed estuary like, let's say, Halama Creek Estuary, and a relatively impacted one like, let's say, Mission or Sycamore. For example, with diversity, we might have 15 families of invertebrates at Halama. We might have 10 or 12 at Mission. That's a pretty small difference compared to the creeks, where we might have 6 in Lower Mission Creek, and we might have 25 or 30 in Rattlesnake Creek and the headwaters. And this does make sense that this is the case. The estuary is obviously a very harsh environment, especially with salinity. Salinity is a real controlling factor for the composition of the invertebrate and the vertebrate community in estuaries, and that fluctuates so much that it just makes it difficult for anything to live there. So you have fewer organisms that can survive there, so when you have less to look at, it makes sense that it's harder to see changes. But we have been able to see something. There's two metrics that we looked at that actually showed some pretty major differences. So we have percent BAIM, which, not to get too technical, that's betadae, amphipod, isopod, and mystidae, which is a shrimp. So we're looking at all four of those combined. What percentage of the total sample are they? That turned out to be what looks like a more sensitive metric. Those bugs having at least collectively having a much higher proportion in the reference estuaries, so that's represented by the blue there, compared to our red and green, which are moderately disturbed and highly disturbed estuaries. So you see a big difference there. That's for the fall sampling we did last year. If you look at the percent COCO, which is copepod, ostracod, cladocera, and oligakete combined, those were much lower combined in the reference estuaries and much higher in our disturbed and intermediate and our moderately disturbed, which is actually Tecolote. We classified that as a moderately disturbed estuary. So we did see a good spread with our fall sampling. Just to point out, the purple, that's our spring sampling from the year before. We didn't really see so much of a pattern there. This is a little bit complicated, this slide. Just bear with me. We got two more to go here. What this is basically showing, just to kind of break it down for you, we're looking at those same metrics, but we're looking at them in different salinities. Because the salinity is such a controlling factor in all the literature that we've reviewed. Huge controlling factor for determining invertebrate community. And a lot of studies have come up with a conclusion that they haven't had very good success distinguishing between disturbed and undisturbed sites in low salinities. They've had much better success in the higher salinities. We were able to kind of tease this out. So under 5 parts per thousand salinity, our reference site still had really high percent BAIM, which is a sensitive metric, and it still had low percent COCO. The moderately disturbed site and highly disturbed site were the opposite. So that pattern that we saw overall held true in the low salinity, and you also see it holding in the moderate salinity. And then we just had one high salinity site, which was a disturbed one, AB3. That's over 18 parts per thousand, so that's about half as saline as seawater. But we see, at least in that estuary, we see the pattern holding as well. So it looks like these two metrics have some promise. It's important to realize they do. They look like they could be indicator metrics, but we have a very small data set. We only have 9 sites that we're drawing from right now. Before we did our first creeks IBI, we had over 100 creek sites. We're probably not going to get to 100 estuary sites anytime soon, but we're definitely going to need more replication to further evaluate these relationships and also to look at some of our other metrics that showed some split, you know, between the disturbed and the undisturbed. They may take a lot more replication to really see if those relationships are reliable. What we'd like to do is get maybe 4 to 6 indicator metrics over the course of the next several years and see if we can compile an estuarine IBI for the local area that has some reliability. So that's kind of our goal with the estuaries. This is a little out of order, and I kind of already mentioned it, but we're going to continue sampling in the fall from here on out, being that we saw much better results, and which kind of makes sense because our water chemistry and salinity, temperature, oxygen concentrations do stabilize through the summer, which gives a community a chance to get established in the estuaries, whereas it doesn't really have that opportunity in the spring, usually. Thanks so much for your attention. And just anybody have any questions or concerns? Leanne?
Thank you so much for your presentation. That was really interesting.
You're welcome.
Given that this was a really low rain year, we're way behind in rainfall, is there anything that you're anticipating or we should be concerned about as we think about the creeks and some of our programs for the creeks, given the low rain year?
Right. Well, as far as our sampling goes and our program goes, we definitely have seen that. I mean, the creeks are really low. It's just up there today and real low flow levels. And we do see differences. You'll see some changes in the IBI scores. Nothing real crazy. But as far as management goes, I mean, it's natural. This is part of the natural climatic cycle here. But I think the best thing is to let the creeks be as natural as possible. Sure.
I wanted to follow up because I had a similar question to that. So you said it'll affect the IBI score, make it go down a little bit, but we won't see dramatic declines like after a big storm year or after fires.
What we've actually seen is it spreads the scores a little bit more. It doesn't affect the mean score so much. In some years where we've had drought, it's actually gone up a little bit. In some years, it's gone down a little bit. Right. It's not going to be a major change like what we had with that huge scouring season in 2005. So the IBI seems to be able to handle certain natural perturbations, and then it shows others. So we have to kind of understand that when we're looking at these scores, and that way we don't jump the gun and say, well, something must have happened in Rattlesnake Creek. There must have been a spill or something because the IBI scores are low. We have to look at some of the natural things that might have happened too that previous winter. Lee?
Yeah, thank you. That was an excellent report. You've been updating these reports for 12 or 13 years now?
That's right. Yeah, we've been doing the monitoring for...
And you've indicated that there's variations and fluctuations in certain individual categories, including, I guess you were just saying, rainfall is one of them. I was looking for a metric or an indicator where... I didn't see it in this report. Maybe in the next one where you're able to match up the amount of sidewalk washing that happens in downtown with the health of creek watersheds, either in the channel or up in the foothills, because I know some members of the public think that more plants or more washing of State Street for shoppers will have a profound benefit on creek health. And I was wondering, in your 12 or 13 years of assessment, have you ever come up with any kind of a correlation to support that?
Well, no. The answer is no. We haven't looked at that. Obviously, more street sweeping. Anytime we're doing that, hopefully we're removing some of the pollutants, right? That's, I guess, the whole point behind it. There's so many variables though that affect the creeks. There's so many natural things that can affect them. Other man-made things, you know, illicit discharges, changes in watershed development. You know, you have new development go in. So it's very difficult unless you do an isolated scientific experiment, which you could do in a laboratory or in a manufactured creek where you hold every other variable constant and then you change that. That would be kind of how you could pinpoint it. But what we can do is we can look at all of these measures that we take, all the whole stormwater plan and the individual restoration projects and whatnot. And we can look at the cumulative effect of those over time and see what kind of a beneficial impact we're having. So this program does help us do that, and we have set a few of our sites to be directly in those individual restoration projects. So good for that.
Thank you for that. I just have a couple questions. As part of your matrix, did you look at whether the mouths of the estuaries are open or closed and how it affects some of your species?
That's a good question. We do note that. And that's something that would be really interesting to look at. There was some variability. Some of the mouths were closed this past fall, and a couple of them were open. If we get a larger data set and we can have more replication, let's say we have a reference group and we have open mouth, unopened mouth, then it would be very easy to see if there's any statistical difference between those two.
You do make a note of that.
We do. As part of our general observations, that is one of the things for estuaries that we note.
Good, because there's a debate going on whether to open mouths with flus or not. That would be actually very important to know.
Right.
Timely.
And the water chemistry would be interesting to look at with that, too. You know, if we're doing it at a set time each year, and there's a lot of other variables that affect it, but that is, like you said, a very significant management issue and something that we could evaluate.
Now, open or closed mouth would have a pretty significant effect on salinity and probably temperature as
it
well.
It should.
Dissolved oxygen.
DO.
And there's other factors, too, like how much input are we getting from the stream up above? What have the tide conditions been? Are we getting any flow over the berm if it's there? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of things going on there. But, you know, sometimes a nice thing about looking at statistics is even though there are other confounding variables, if the relationship is strong enough, sometimes you'll see through that.
So, hopefully.
Yeah.
And the other thing is a little off topic, but you said the estuary in Halama is fairly healthy. Now, I have just heard that early 1900s, the railroad artificially dug a pool in Halama Creek so they would have a water source for the steam engine as they went up and down the track. Is that now part of the estuary? Do you know about anything about this pool?
No, I haven't heard about
apparently,
that.
Apparently it's a barrier, too.
Is it at the upstream end there? Or?
I have no idea. I have no idea exactly where it is. I just heard about it for the first time, and I was wondering if it was part of the estuary or not.
Okay.
I'm assuming it's somewhere by the railroad tracks. I just don't even know if it's on county property.
Right.
Or
yeah, we actually didn't actually get that high up into that estuary because that's all the way at the upstream end. We kind of were more in the lower to mid sections of it, so I wouldn't really know about that. Our criteria where we're looking at health, we're looking at the whole watershed and what percentage of that is developed, basically, either urban or ag, and then we look at our, for estuaries, that's pretty much all we're looking at right now. We don't really have a physical habitat assessment for the estuaries yet.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome. Anything else? No? Okay.
Thank you,
thank you very much.
Thanks, Jeff.
Got it.
All right, we're going to move on to our second item here, which is a status report on our State Water Resources Control Board National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System General Permit. And I think Cameron wants to do a quick intro.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yes, I wanted to introduce this because this is a regulatory program that has been going through a lot of changes over the past 2 years. This is the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System, or NPDES system, is a program under the Federal Clean Water Act. And the US EPA has delegated their authority to the State Water Board, who's delegated their authority to the regional water boards, and they issue permits to cities all across California and all across the country to discharge water from the storm drain system into the creeks and into the ocean. And over the past 2 years, the state's been going through a process of readopting its five-year permit for all the municipalities to comply with. And it affects our stormwater management program. That's really our permit in this case. And a lot of other development projects, both private and public development projects in the city. And Autumn Malanka and I have been working with the Regional Water Board and the State Water Board over the last 2 years, and we've been trying to find the right time to come to the committee to kind of explain what's been going on. And everything's been sort of in flux, and it's all kind of come to a head now. So I just wanted to give a little background because this is a super bureaucratic system. I mean, it's incredible. And so we're going to try to just break it into a few pieces and explain it. If you get confused, don't feel bad. It's like I said, it's really bureaucratic. It's not necessarily complex, but unnecessarily bureaucratic. So if there's something you don't understand, you can stop Autumn as she's going through the presentation, and we'll try to give you an understanding of what's going on. And then at the end, we're going to be looking for some action from the committee on a recommendation to the City Council and the City Council's Ordinance Committee, because one of the requirements for us going forward is adopting a stormwater ordinance into our municipal code. So with that, I'll turn it over to our Creeks Division Water Resources Specialist, Autumn Malanka.
Thank you, Mr. Benson. And thanks everyone for having me. I'm here just about every May, and Yeah, I'm happy to be here. Hopefully with that introduction, no one starts to fall asleep too early in the beginning, but it is bureaucratic, but I'm going to make this as interesting as possible. So you already heard the title here once of what I'm going to be talking about. I think I can pick it. It's just roll. Thank you. Okay. So stormwater management requirements, that comes from the Clean Water Act all the way back in 1972. So it's been over 40 years. And from that came our NPDES, or National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System requirements, that went through a couple of phases. And when phase two hit, those regulations began governing stormwater flows and discharges from cities. So the State Water Board and the Regional Water Quality Control Boards actually require implementation of these regulations from their permittees, and we as a city as a permittee. The State Water Board just recently adopted this new NPDES general permit. I'll just refer to it as the general permit through my presentation in February of 2013, but they've been working on this revised permit since about 2011. So it's been a couple years. The city's stormwater management program, as Cameron mentioned, is essentially our permit that complies with this, with the general permit. We call it our SWMP. It's implemented by all city staff, but the Creeks Division has provided overall coordination since its inception over the past about 6 or 8 years. It has been in place formally since 2006. And our most recent 2012 annual report was just submitted to the Water Board in March. It's due in March every year. And usually that's what my presentation to the advisory committee is about, is what have we done this past year with our stormwater management program? What are our successes? Any possible changes? But I won't get into that this time. I'm going to talk more about the changes that have been going on with the general permit. But overall, our year four 2012 annual permit demonstrated once again that the city of Santa Barbara has a successful and effective program that we're pretty proud of. So the new permit for stormwater discharges, or the general permit, the Creeks staff, we've tracked this for the past couple of years. They started drafts in 2011, and the Water Board finally adopted the new permit in February early this year. And there's some changes that this brings to all the permittees. There's kind of a new program overall structure. There's some new requirements and standards, and that's where the rubber hits the road for us as a city. We have to figure out how to meet these new requirements, and there's some new reporting requirements as well. So I'll start with kind of the programmatic structural changes that this new general permit brings to us. In general, the city's permittees, we all use to submit our stormwater management programs to the regional water quality control boards and say, here you go, this is what we propose to do to comply with the general permit stormwater requirements. The regional board staff would review it and 9 times out of 10 come back with a bunch of requested changes, but the SWMPs were something that were in constant flux, but that was how we complied with the general permit. Now, there's a new concept called a guidance document, and those are basically going to replace effectively our SWMPs. Things that aren't necessarily important for you all to know is that it's a table now. It's a table format instead of a big textual document. Basically, the table just defines the requirements. Here's the new general permit requirements, and it assigns implementation to the responsible city staff. What's important to know is that effectively the SWMP, our SWMP, we're still doing what we're doing. It's not changing so much. It's not going away in reality. Where our best management practices that we've been implementing through our stormwater management program are going to stay the same. They're going to continue. And the new requirements in the general permit that will now be identified in this guidance document will be delegated to the appropriate staff. So we're working internally to make sure that happens. The other big programmatic kind of structural change is that the online reporting actually replaces the annual SWMP reports that I've been submitting to the board here. It's an online SMARTS program, it's called. A few new requirements that are actual changes for new best management practices that the city will have to be implementing. One of them is called a community-based social marketing requirement for education and outreach. So our education and outreach staff person will be working to implement that. It's just a different concept on how to approach education and outreach. There's some more specific illicit discharge detection and elimination program requirements. An example of that is that the general permit requires that all permittees actually have very specific inventories of all of our commercial and industrial facilities within the boundaries of our purview, and that we actually inspect these commercial and industrial facilities. So that's some more staff time. There's some new mapping requirements that we have to submit showing that we actually know where these places are, that kind of thing. It's kind of a bigger one for a lot of permittees. Luckily, the city of Santa Barbara has a pretty good program in place already for this, is new water quality and water sampling requirements. Again, we're relatively ahead of the curve in this regard. There's some new construction requirements that staff will be working mostly with the building department to be sure that we'll be meeting these new requirements for new kind of more specific inventories of construction sites, some more specific inspection requirements as far as dates and timing, and then enforcement requirements. And last but not least, there's new regulations for development and redevelopment projects. And those are called post-construction requirements, or designs that are actually in a project that manage stormwater. And that's kind of been the big change, or the big new requirement that's been getting a lot of attention in the new general permit, mainly because specifically for our region, the Central Coast region, has developed post-construction requirements on their own that are different, separate from the state. And that has been a process that's everyone has referred to as the joint effort, because Central Coast did work with the other permittees and cities over the past 2 years to develop these new post-construction requirements. So we've been sort of waiting and waiting to see what they were going to come up with despite our input. So these post-construction requirements, like I said, have kind of been a focus. What was interesting that kind of came about towards the very end of this two-year joint effort process was that there was a provision that showed up in the post-construction requirements for cities to actually continue their pre-existing program requirements for post-construction via an exemption. So an exemption option was in there. And after our city staff closely reviewed the Central Coast PCRs, I'll call them, we decided to apply for an exemption. We applied toward the end of 2012, and we received the exemption from the Central Coast Water Board in early January of this year. So a lot of reasons why we applied for the exemption. The main one being that after we compared the Central Coast PCRs to the city's existing PCRs that we've been implementing for the past 6 years now, we came to the conclusion that our program protects water quality better, simply because our program is more specific to the city. Also, the city has successfully, I mentioned, we've been implementing these post-construction requirements informally since 2006 and formally since 2008. So it's been about 6 years that not only city staff, but all the design community, contractors, engineers, have become familiar with our requirements and the actual designs that successfully meet the requirements. I should mention one other thing. The guidance manual that we developed, the Stormwater Best Management Practices Guidance Manual, was also part of that effort of coming up with our post-construction requirements, and that included a lot of extensive outreach with the community, internal staff meetings of figuring out how to make a program that's applicable to our city, and then obviously consultant costs. So one other piece to this puzzle that goes along with the with these Central Coast requirements is that there's a little clause in there that says we have to implement these post-construction requirements through enforceable mechanisms, i.e. municipal codes, by September 6, 2013. So the city is proposing to simply codify our existing post-construction requirements into the municipal code, which has not happened to date. So the plan, or next steps we'll call them, now that we have the requirements in hand and we understand that we are an exempt permittee from the post-construction requirements, the first step is to get the stormwater ordinance drafted, which we've been working with the city attorney over the past several months to do that, and present that stormwater ordinance to the ordinance committee in about a month, in June. The next step, obviously, is to present to council by early September. And while we're doing that, concurrently, we'll also be completing that guidance document that I talked about, which we have to submit to the State Water Board to be in compliance with the new general permit, along with our new notice of intent to comply with the general permit. All that has to be submitted to the Water Board by July 1st, 2013, which is when the general permit becomes effective. And that's as simple as I can keep it. Thank you. Questions? Chair Moldaver.
Former chair.
Yeah. you know what I mean.
thank you, Ms. Milanka. I was just wondering, do you anticipate if the city shifts the existing stormwater management plan and program into an ordinance form, will there be any additional cost or any additional staffing under a perennial ordinance rather than an annual program or plan?
I'm going to defer to Cameron about that. We talk about this a lot, but I think he'll be more eloquent than I. Costs.
No.
So yeah. No,
Lee, we've been implementing the stormwater management program since it was approved by the Water Board in, actually, since it was approved by City Council in 2006. It was approved officially by the Water Board in 2009. We're just putting the standards and the thresholds that are in the existing program into the municipal code, and it'll have no effect on the way that it is implemented.
So in terms of budget fees, staffing, it'll basically be the same as it is now?
Correct.
Because I know from my meetings over the years with the Chamber of Commerce and the Conference and Visitors Bureau that what most businesses and property owners that I interact with are all looking for consistency and reliability so they can plan their process, whether it's to do a remodel or just to figure out what the annual cost of properly maintaining their property is. So obviously, rather than bring a new plan to the City Council every year or two, which will take staff time and council agenda time and taxpayer time, it seems to me if we could take what we're already doing successfully and simply take that stormwater management plan and program and make it into an ordinance with no other changes, that would be a win-win because there'd be no additional cost. It'll be saving time and money on the council side. It'll be saving time and money on the business side. So I just wanted to get that background because I'd like to move the committee recommend to the City Council that they take the existing stormwater management plan and program and adopt them as they stand today as an ordinance that would be a permanent ordinance of the City of Santa Barbara, and if they see fit to refer it to the ordinance committee to work on the language.
Is there a second for that?
I second that.
All right. Thank you. All in favor?
You want to see if there are questions,
oh.
But I wanted to just respond.
Okay.
You can have more discussion. I wanted to just respond to that. When the state was going through its new permit adoption process, and then the Regional Water Board was coming up with all of these requirements that they were going to put on to developers, you know, as Autumn said, that's been going on for the last couple of years. That was only 2 years after we just adopted this whole new regulatory program in the city. And so We were working internally. We were working with the design and development communities to try to understand this whole new regulatory structure that the city was under. And so it was frustrating to be in a situation where some new regulatory structure was going to be imposed on us from a state agency. So one of the things that city staff did over the last 2 years was work on carving out the exemption or the exception that Autumn mentioned, and it's essentially an exception that says if you have an existing program and the program is in place and it's providing as good or better water quality benefits on the ground than what we're proposing, they will review your program and pass judgment on it and whether or not to allow you to keep going with that existing program. So we were successful at getting that exception put into the permit, and then, as Autumn said, we applied for it, and I think Santa Barbara was the only community that was granted approval.
Santa Cruz was too.
Santa Cruz and Lompoc, but they were conditional.
They were conditional. So ours, yeah. I was going to say, ours, Santa Barbara was the only one that was approved in its present form, without any changes, and so. And so part of our motivation, Mr. Moldaver, was to not have that switch and not have to go through that. And at the same time, we really felt that for the city of Santa Barbara, the program that we put in place would provide a better water quality benefit in the end compared to the program, you know, that's being put in place for five counties. So. So I think it's a lot less complicated and a lot more effective for us.
Madam Chair, I don't mean to debate with our staff, but I think that's kind of a roundabout way of saying that if we take this approach and the committee approves the motion, that we will be optimizing our local control over these issues and this plan. And I think local control is something that every resident, property owner, and business person supports when compared to turning it over to a state agency, you know, that's far away and has their own analysis and cost evaluation procedure. So I think not just the consistency, but the local control makes this an ordinance I think the county, the city council should seriously consider.
I have just one question. In looking at the new regulations that are coming down from the state or the more regional, are there any suggestions, any regulations that would perhaps be beneficial for us in the future? Are there new ideas, new programs, or new methods, or any new ideas that are there that we should make note of? As you know, future consideration as we go forward, because I know as a city we want to continually improve our process and make sure we've got healthy creeks and estuaries and ocean to swim in. So just looking for those bright ideas in what's been prepared.
I'm trying to think of how to respond to this without sounding overly confident for the city approach to things. Very similar to when we created the stormwater management program, the city created the stormwater management program back in 2003, 2004, 2005. A lot of the requirements that the general permit was imposing on the permittees were things that the city was already doing. And then we got creative and came up with some new ones. And to some extent, it's a similar situation with this new general permit. A lot of the requirements are things that we can actually demonstrate that the different departments and divisions are already doing in one way or another. There are some new specific requirements. What's different really in general about this new general permit is that the requirements get a lot more specific. And before, it was more general, the requirements. And so luckily, we are doing a lot of these specific things. But there's some new things, like I mentioned in my presentation, for finding illicit discharges, finding where things, pollutants are making their way into our storm drain system, is oftentimes from commercial or industrial facilities. And so this general permit has the, in my opinion, beneficial requirement of let's map those all out, let's do some inventories, and make it a requirement that we have to do inspections annually. So that kind of thing is beneficial.
So if I understand it correctly, if we suggest motion to move the existing plan to an ordinance, that process that you suggested, would we also be taking on some of these new things, such as the inventory and enforcement, or not?
That's a good question. And this is part of what's confusing, and I'm not sure we're helping by the presentation, because there's
moving parts.
Yeah, there's a lot of moving parts here. So the state's general permit sort of sets a floor in a lot of different categories, and some of the and one of those categories we pulled out and put a lot of focus on, and that is the what they call the post-construction requirements. And so those are water quality best management practices that are imposed on development projects, both private and public development projects. But that's only one part of the general permit. So the permit also includes some of the things Autumn mentioned, with outreach requirements and monitoring requirements and mapping requirements and reporting requirements. And so that it's a really broad-based program that's being mandated by the state. And so we will have to do all those things, but we're not putting any of those things into the stormwater ordinance. So what's being called the stormwater ordinance will just be those post-construction requirements. So we're just taking that component of our stormwater management program, of our existing stormwater management program, and putting that part into the municipal code. So it won't be the whole statewide permit, it'll just be our development rules.
I'm glad you asked that question. It's important to know.
That's why I was trying to do the introduction, just to let you know this thing is really, it's really bureaucratic. And so that's a good question, and hopefully that clears that up. Good.
I just had a question. What's the duration of the exemption? Is there a point in time when we have to apply for that again, or is that?
No. It's a 5-year permit, technically. That's how the 2003 permit was presented to permittees. Granted, it took the State Water Board 10 years to write it. So technically, we are exempt as long as this permit is in effect.
Are there any further questions?
I would just add that if the city did want to go back and make changes to that program later on, we would have to reapply and be reapproved for that exemption.
Can we get a vote then on the motion that's been put forward to recommend the City Council approve a stormwater ordinance? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Awesome. Can we get a motion to adjourn this meeting?
I move that we adjourn this meeting.
All right.